Previously, we have talked about the axially loaded elements, and we have learned that stressing those elements is going to be F over A. I want to briefly review that and compare that with what we have learned on torsional elements. So consider one axially loaded element with a constant cross-sectional area, which is subjected to a force of F. If you want to determine stress, that would be force over area, and we know that stress is going to be normal stress. In that case, force depends on the loading. So if we have higher loading acting on a system, that means that the internal force increases. Area, on the other side, depends on the cross section and also depending on the shape of the section. We also learned how to determine stresses in the torsional elements. In that case, we have learned that stress is going to be Tc over J. One difference is that we do have shear stress on torsional elements as opposed to normal stress in the axially loaded elements. Also, the equation looks a little bit different, Tc over J. Now let's look at the components in this equation. Torque is depending on the loading, so that is comparable to F. C is the distance of the point of interest to the centroid. If the cross-section is a circle, that would be half of the diameter. And J would be pi over 32 diameter to the fourth. So we can see that C and J both depend on the shape of the section or the dimension of the section. So let me write it down in this format. I would write it as T divided by J over C. Now we can see on the denominator of this equation, we have torque, which depends on the loading. And on the denominator, we have J over C, both depending on the shape and the dimension of the section. Okay? Compare it with this one. So we can see both of these equations are having the same nature. If I want to develop equations for deformation, how that would look like? This is what we want to talk about today. Remember, the deformation equation for the axially loaded element was FL over EA. Okay, so hopefully we can develop an equation which is somehow similar to this equation. Okay, so let's do that together, and that's the fun part. Consider one simple torsional element like this, which is subjected to a torque at the right end and has a constant cross-sectional area, and it is fixed at the left end. We have learned if put this element under torque, this element is going to twist. And in that case, you can see that the cross-sectional area remains as a circle. It doesn't deform, but it simply twists. So in that case, I want to look into this part carefully and determine how much would be the total twist of the shaft, say at the right end of this shaft. I'm going to take out one small, tiny portion of this shaft and draw that bigger here. Now look at the side line of this element. So it was originally here, and because of that deformation, it has moved downward. So we can see that the right part of this shaft is twisted a little bit more compared to the left side. At this point, we see the change in the angle. I'm going to call that gamma. What is the change in the angle? It is shear strain. We have learned that previously at the beginning of mechanics of materials. So gamma stands for shear strain. In that equation, I can say that tangent of gamma is going to be d prime d double prime divided by the length, which is delta x. Okay, I'm going to keep that here. Also, I know one fact. If that change in the angle is tiny and small, which is the case for our problem, I can say that gamma is equal to the tangent of gamma. Now let me look at this from front view. I'm going to call this angle here a delta phi. Note that this angle is not the same as gamma that we have here. That's a different angle. Can someone tell me if there is a way for me to determine this distance, d prime, d double prime, this arc length, based on this angle and the radius, which I assume is C? Okay, so that would be C, or the radius, multiplied by this angle. Now I'm going to plug that back into this equation and see what we get. So we say gamma is equal to C multiplied by delta phi divided by delta x. Now, what is the relationship between stress and strain in the shear problem? Exactly. So tau is G multiplied by gamma. So gamma, as we determined from that equation, is going to be C delta phi divided by delta x. All right. What is stress equation in the torsional element? Tc over J. I'm going to plug that back here. So we say Tc over J is going to be G multiplied by C delta phi divided by delta x. C is going to cancel out from the site. If I reorder that in terms of delta phi and the rest of the parameters, we have T divided by GJ multiplied by delta X. All right. If the deformation is very small, it means that this phi and delta X could be written as a differential equation. So I, instead of delta phi, I can say d phi is t divided by gj multiplied by dx. What does it mean? It shows the amount of twist in one tiny slice of the element that we showed at the beginning. If we have infinite number of those tiny pieces and put them together, so I can say that phi is simply integral of d phi from 0 to L to the length of the element, and I will do the same on the right side equation. So integral of t divided by gj dx. That's it. That is the equation that we were looking for. This equation gives us the amount of twist in the torsional elements. Let's look at each of these components. If it's made of just one material, what does it mean? That means G is constant. So in that case, I can take out that constant out of the equation. What if the section is just subjected to one constant torque? In that case, the torque remains constant throughout the section. So I can also take out T out of the integral. What about J? If the cross-sectional area has a constant diameter, J could also be taken out of the integral. So what remains in the integral? Dx. If you integrate dx from 0 to L, what would be the result? That would be the length of the element, or L. So we can simplify the twist equation as TL over GJ, and that's the equation that you are looking for. However, this equation has some restrictions. What are those restrictions? Torque has to be constant, G has to be constant, and J has to be constant. It means that there should be just one torque, there should be constant cross-sectional area, and it should be made from just one material. Okay, so that is the equation that we developed for torsional elements. On the axially loaded element, we have previously seen that deformation is FL over EA. If we have system of axially loaded elements connected together, we have sum of FL over EA for each part. And if the element has a variable cross-sectional area, or if the loading is variable, we need to use integral equation. Now compare that with torsional elements. If everything is constant, we use TL over GJ. Now compare that with the deformation equation that we previously had. T is comparable with F. They are both representing force or loading. L is the same. Instead of E or modulus of elasticity, we have G or modulus of rigidity. Why? Because in axially loaded element, we work with normal stress. So those are going to be related with modulus of elasticity. But in torsional elements, we work with shear stress, and they are related with modulus of rigidity. The other property is area, which shows the cross-sectional shape of the element. And here on the left side for the torsional elements, we have J, which also represents the cross-sectional area of the element. Okay, if we have system of connected shafts, we use sum of TL over GJ. And if the system is subjected to variable loading or variable cross-sectional area, we need to use the integration equation. Okay, last part that I want to talk about is the sign convention. In torsional elements, we need to use the correct sign in order to add up the deformations together. For stresses, we don't care about the sign of torque because that would just change the direction of stress, which doesn't matter. As opposed to the axially loaded elements, for axially loaded elements, materials may behave differently in compression and tension. But for torsion or shear stress, that would just change the direction where the shear stress is acting on, which in most cases, it doesn't matter. So we do care about torsion sign when we want to add up the deformations or twists together. In the axially loaded element, we said that if the element is under tensile force, we assume it's positive. If it's compressive, we assume it's negative. In a torsional element, we use the right-hand rule and the double arrow. Torque is actually a type of moment. In these cases, we replace the torque with double arrow in order to make it more visible in the two-dimensional problems. The rule is like this. Curl the finger toward the direction of the arrow, thumb is going to show you the direction of the equivalent devil arrow. So like for this problem on the right side, if you curl the finger, the devil arrow is going to be outward from the surface. And on the left side, the devil arrow is going to the left side. So these two devil arrows are going to two different directions, but both of them are positive. The rule we have for torque is that if the devil arrow that represents the torque is outward from the cut surface, that is positive. So in this case, both of these two devil arrows are going to be outward from the surface. So we are going to assume that they are positive.
The next video, we are going to solve some examples to understand how to use these equations in order to determine twist in torsional elements.